Okay, thank you. So I'm Olivier Le Villain, and I'm with Aina Toki Razor-Manana. We work at Telecom Sud Paris. I'm an assistant professor there, and Aina worked on this during his internship, and he's now a PhD student with me at Telecom Sud Paris. So we are going to speak about RSA and an attack that you might already know of, that is Bleichenbacher, and we try to write some code about this attack. So I will let Aina speak a little with about RSA and Bleichenbacher.
Okay. For our talk, we are going to see a little reminder about RSA and PKS1 version 1.5. And after, we are going to see the Bleichenbacher algorithm and the tool that we have developed during my internship, and after our current results and future work. Bleichenbacher attack is an attack against the PKS1 version 1.5 SEM. As you all know, RSA is an asymmetric encryption and signature. It is a cryptographic widely used today. It's ubiquitous. And whether for encryption or signature. In this talk, we note N and D, the RSA public key, and D, the private key. For encryption, we need to use the public key NND to compute the ciphertext corresponding to the message M. For this, we need to compute M power E modulo N. And for decryption, we need to use this formula. But RSA has some problem. For example, if E and M are small. But another problem for RSA is also the malleability with respect to the multiplication. We will see later that we can exploit this weakness of RSA to realize the Bleichenbacher attack. PKS1 is a standard that describes how to use RSA. It describes the use of padding before encryption. And the padding sum varies depending on the version of PKS1. In this talk, we are most interested in padding type 2, described in version 1.5 of the standard and used for encryption. For example, if we want to encrypt encapsulated data, first, we need to add 2 bytes, 0002, followed by at least 8 non-zero random bytes. And all these messages must have the same length of the modulus n in bytes. PKS1 version 1.5 have three padding type. The padding type 2 that we had seen already, and the padding type 0, padding type 1. The padding type 0 is already used. The padding type 1 is used for signature. For padding type 1, instead of adding at least 8 random bytes, we need to add at least 8 8 times the FFF bytes. Currently, there is also PKCS1 version 2.1 that describes web optimal asymmetric encryption padding for encryption and PSS probabilistic signature SEM for signature. While PKCS1 version 2.1 is better, have better security properties, it's not always used in standard. Bread and butter attack is an old attack dating from 1988. To better understand the bread and butter attack, note that if we have a message correctly formatted, described in this figure, we know that the message was starting by the byte 002. And because the message is starting by this byte, so if we interpret this message as an integer, this means that the message M is between 2b and 3b, where b equals to 2 power size of n in bits minus 16. To realize the present butcher attack, we need to have access to an oracle, which accept to decrypt a messages and return true when the padding was correct and false otherwise. When the oracle receive an encrypted message, first he decrypted the message and he check if the decrypted message is correctly formatted or not. If so, he returns true and false otherwise. To recover the plain text corresponding to the to SFR text C, an attacker choose an integer S and compute C multiplied by S power E. And after, he send it to the server. When the server receives the message, he decrypts the message corresponding to the decrypted message is corresponding to M multiplied by S, and he check if MS is correctly formatted. If so, he return true. When the attacker receives the message, if the message that he has received is true, so he can deduce some information about the decrypted message, M multiplied by S. Because the message was starting by, he know that the message, the decrypted message was starting by the byte 0002. And he deduce this inequality. If an attacker makes enough requests to the server, he can recover the message M using this inequality. In practice, the attacker wants to find messages starting with the byte 0002. However, some oracles makes additional checks. Some oracles didn't check only if the message was starting by 002, but they check also if there is really at least 8 random bytes. To realize the present virtual attack,
In this example, we look at an example of what a server could do. It would respond only true when all these conditions are verified. So he will check that the padding is actually correct, but all the conditions. And this is not very interesting for the attacker because the attacker will lose some good messages. So sometimes he will send encrypted data that will correspond to a clear text starting with 0002, but he will still get a false. So this one won't get him any equations. So this is why sometimes we have less efficient oracles, which would check other conditions. And we have the beyond the original paper from Bleichenbacher, Bardou et al. Proposed to analyze this kind of oracles that would do more checks than just verifying that it starts with 0002, and they showed that in practice you had different types of oracles. The simplest one and the one that the attacker wants to find is this one, TTT. That's okay. I won't explain exactly why, what is true and false, but because I will make a mistake. But this one is the simplest one, that is, as soon as the message, the clear text message starts with 0002, you have true. So this is a perfect oracle because every good message in the sense of the attacker can use it to get an equation, gets him an equation. And if you have more checks that are being done, you lose some good messages. And so to run the attack, you not only have to send 40,000 encrypted messages, but okay, it's also 40, but it can go up to 200 in with the original algorithm. And in the case where all checks are done and that the server will also check that the message obtained has the right size, it was impossible to run the original attack in a decent time. So they proposed an improved algorithm which allows to have better numbers from the attacker's point of view. And we see that, again, this is the perfect oracle from the attacker's point of view. So now I will speak about Wombat, which is the tool that Aina and I worked on during his internship. So to test an implementation, we will write a stub, which basically is a chunk of code that will interact with the implementation I want to test. So this stub will get me the RSA public key, will also give me a challenge, an encrypted message that I have to decrypt. And afterwards, I can submit encrypted messages that will be decrypted. So this is just the stub. And from that, the attacker will use this stub to send several different messages, which will be well formed. Some will start with 0002, some won't work, won't start with 0002. Some will have some of the checks that will pass and other won't. And he will observe the behavior of the server, of the implementation that is tested. So from that, an attacker can send a very limited number of messages and infer that the implementation is or not an oracle. And he will also be able to say that it's a TTT oracle or a TFT oracle, because it will, it can learn that the implementation makes this check or not before having this behavior. So now that the attacker, if the attacker finds an oracle, that is, that he finds a way to observe good messages in a reliable way, he knows that he has an oracle and he can exploit it. What can we do When we have this, we can evaluate more precisely the cost of the attack, because sometimes you have some probabilities. It might not be as clean as what I just said. So sometimes you will send several messages of a certain type and try to know what happens from what you can observe. You also can attack the implementation to recover a plain text, but you could also use the attack to compute an exponentiation to the power of D, which would allow you to sign a message which would be accepted by the public key afterwards. So currently, Aina implemented the original attack from Blechenbauer. He also implemented some versions of the improved attacks proposed in the paper from Crypto 2012. We have implemented pure oracles to test that the attacks actually work, and we also implemented a TLS stub, which allows us to identify and exploit oracles in TLS stacks. So this is an open source framework. It was written in Python. We have a version 0.1 that was published. So it's on GitLab. What can you use that for? It can help you audit and identify problems in existing implementations. You can mount attacks, of course, with respect to the law and the morality. I count on you for that. And you can also, because I'm a teacher, use that to mount hands-on sessions in classes. So we have also a simple TCP server that's very, very simpler than TLS to help mounting a challenge for the students that want to use and to implement the attack. So what did we do with Wombat for now? Since I do like TLS, I have this figure in each and every of my presentation. So TLS is this, up until TLS 1.3. That is, you have messages exchanged from the client to the server to and back to negotiate the parameters you will use. And in the case that we are interested in, we will use RSA PKCS1 version 1.5 to encrypt the master secret. And this is done. Okay, first you have the message certificate that gives you the RSA public key from the server. And if the the server uses the right algorithms for the attacker, you will have in this message an encrypted message containing an RSA encrypted data. So this is what we are going to do. We are going to get the public key and interact with the server by sending there some encrypted data using this message, client key exchange. So this is exactly what our stub does, getting the public key and then including the ciphertext we want to use to mount the attack in the client key exchange message, and observe what's happening. Because at the beginning we don't know if we have an oracle, so we have to look at every possible thing that the server can do that may help us distinguish the case where the padding is good. So we know it starts with 0002 and we've got an equation, and the other case. Okay, we wanted to check this on a real implementation. So we took a very good implementation, which is embed TLS, which is robust against this attack. So we added some code, which is, don't do this at home. It's just saying that if the padding is wrong, send an explicit alert. This is the most obvious way to produce an oracle. And of course, embed TLS is not originally subject to the attack. So if I can show you how this works. So here is a vulnerable server. So this is the embed TLS with the patch which adds an oracle. And if we from the attacker point of view, we can use Wombat to probe the server, that is send him some very forged packets for which we know the clear text, and we know that the clear text has this property or this one. So we send some messages, and sometimes the server will answer with an error, MAC error, or with another error. And the fact that we have different errors is the way we will be able to distinguish between the interesting case for the attacker and the non-interesting cases. And as expected, the attacker finds that there is an oracle, okay, of type FFT, that is, we check that it starts with 0002, we check that the padding is at least 8 bytes, and we check that there is a message. That is, the padding doesn't go all the way to the end of the message. And the tool gives us the way to attack the server afterwards. It says the true signal, that is, this is an oracle, and you should consider true when the server answers with, okay, an alert of type 21 is it's an alert message, and of type 20, and the false signal is an alert of with the type 51. So we have an explicit message that allows us to distinguish between the true case and the false case. So we can try and run the attack. This might take long because it depends on some stuff. Sometimes it takes a reasonable time. We'll see at the end if we get back there something. Okay. So we tried to do some real life tests on TLS using the prober I just showed you. And, we kind of believe that explicit oracles, the kind that I just described, were not easy to find. But we just tried this on some servers in the wild, and we find exactly what I showed you. That is, some servers will exhibit a behavior where you can distinguish just by looking at the messages you receive. So it's really an explicit oracle. You can distinguish the cases where you will get an equation and the case where there is nothing interesting for you. Oh, by the way, the tested server is from the top Alexa 1 million, which was kind of a surprise to us because okay, we were expecting that some TLS stacks still had this problem, but not for the web and not for the very common websites. So we would like to continue some of this work on TLS to be more reliable and more precise. In particular, with regards to timing attacks, because for now we have a very naive way to look at timing. The time used by the server to answer us, but it's tricky, and you might want to you can be smart to get more information about the timing from the server. We would also like to look at more server behavior. We didn't look in details at what's happening at the TCP layer, which can be useful in some cases, and we might also want to use different triggers to get another behavior from the server, because in the robot attacks they showed that they use different messages to get more information in some cases. It would be interesting to launch real campaigns to look at what's really there out there in the wild. So looking at HTTPS top Alexa 1 million in a regular way. And since we know we will also find some interesting stuff, SMTP servers, which usually are old and not that updated. We also might want to write more sophisticated attack using this framework, like Drown, but this and our signature forgery against something like Quick or TLS 1.3. These are not attacks that will allow us to break TLS 1.3 or Quick, but nevertheless interesting to implement attacks that were described in the literature. Okay, we also wanted to find other applications, because the idea behind Wombat was to have a modular tool that would allow us to just use a different stub. So we had these ideas, XML encryption, SSH, and OpenPGP. So I propose the first one to students. For now, I don't have takers for now, but I believe that some people might be interested in that. Okay, after proposing to Aina to work on SSH, I reread the RFC and I saw that it was not the right version of PKCS1 that was at stake, so it won't work. And for OpenPGP, we did some tests recently, and with this setup, we have an RSA key in a GPG key, which can be used for encryption. We encrypt the message, and we try to decrypt altered version of the encrypted messages. So exactly the same setup as in TLS, but this time by making files that we will feed GPG decrypt. Okay, we send them, and what we got with this, we have different error messages, which allow us to identify an oracle. So GPG decryption of RSA PKCS 1.1 version 1.5 is subject to an oracle. This is not the end of the world. At least this is not the reason why you should not use GPG. There are other ones. But this is not the end of the world, because the case where you would use that as an attack a case where you would be able to send encrypted files, have someone decrypt them for you, and get you the errors back. So this is not unimaginable, it's possible, but it's not the usual way GPG work. But if you had an idea of running GPG on, an SMTP box to automatically decrypt your mail, maybe you would like not to be too verbose about why the decryption failed, because this is the case where you will have an oracle. So GPG is not really, it's not really dangerous, because usually you do not have a way to automatically trigger decryption with GPG. But interesting nevertheless. Okay, in conclusion, was called the million message attack from Bereichenbacher, and which he described in 1998, is an attack that is now very well known. I find it interesting as a teacher, because it's an interesting attack which is not trivial. It's okay, you have to work a little to make it work. What's more annoying is that it's still a reality today, and I didn't dwell on this, but you might have heard of the name because of robot, because of cat, because of, you have every year since 2014, you have a paper, an academic paper that says, oh, by the way, we find another oracle, Bereichenbacher oracle in this case. So it's still a reality, and that's why we wanted to have an open source tool to test the attack, identify oracles where they may exist, to help us reproduce existing attacks, and be extensible to help look at other standards beyond what has already been looked at. And again, this is, I believe, something that may be used for teachers to create hands-on sessions. Okay, thank you for your attention. Here is the slides will be on the website. There you can find them here, and the code is available here. Thank you for your attention.
Thank you so much for the presentation. We have time for questions, comments.
Oh, okay.
Good question. Want to see if it's working.
Okay, things are happening, but it's a little longer. This actually, using TLS for the demo is interesting, because it's a real use case. But problem is, you have a lot of things to do. You are not just making computations. You have I will let it this way. Maybe we'll have something, and we will see some strings with 48 characters. Okay, I can cheat.
Okay.
This is what we would like to see. That is again, okay. We had in this case, okay, in the previous attempts to see this, we had 20,000 calls, so we had to send 20,000 client key exchange key messages, and it was done in 7 minutes. So problem is, it's an FFT Oracle. It's not the best one. The best one is the TTT, and it's not the case of the one we implemented, because we did not want to write too much code to break embed TLS beyond what we needed. So okay. We cheated, but this is what we, and for the planet, I will abort this. Okay.
Other question, comments? Yes.
Thank you for the talk. Is it also, what you describe? Does it also apply to TLS 1.3? Or is it only?
It doesn't apply to TLS 1.3, because the client key exchange message is used in this way to encrypt a master secret that's generated by the client. And this is known as the RSA encryption key exchange method in TLS, and it was removed in TLS 1.3. But in TLS 1.3, you still can use RSA to sign the messages from the server, so you could use an SSL v2 or an old TLS version using the same RSA key as an oracle to forge the signature. However, for the attacker, that won't work because it's very long and the signature should be done during the time of the session. So it's not directly applicable.
Other question, comments? Yes.
Thank you for the talk. You said you didn't launch a systematic campaign, but you tried to find vulnerable servers in the wild. So how many did you test, and how frequently did you find vulnerable servers?
Okay. Okay, we didn't do it because I think I'm lazy, but I think it was only on the top Alexa 1000, and we got explicit oracles, but it was a lot of servers that would depend on the same entity. So we have actually one big case, and we had timing oracles, but since I'm not completely confident in our timing evaluation, it's not that clear that there was a problem.
Okay. Second question. How common is it that clients use this type of padding in communications? So, like, if I were to find an encrypted message, how likely it is that they use this type of vulnerable padding?
Okay. Yes, because the goal for the attacker is to find a TLS message that contains an interesting master secret. So you have to have the client at one point who will send this. Hopefully, for the security, TLS 1.3 is used a lot today, and TLS 1.2 also with other key exchange mechanisms. So in the web, I think this is kind of hard to find. Today, naturally, client and server will use something else. But I believe that in the SMTP world, okay, all bets are possible. So there might be a lot. And also, this is also why we wanted to look at other things. And GPG in this way might be very interesting. But we make the assumption that you can automate the decryption, which is a hard assumption, I think.
Thank you.
We still have time for question, comments? Yes.
Thanks for your talk.
Have you studied hardware implementations like secure elements or TPMs or things like this that also perform some cryptography?
No. Okay, no, we didn't look at them. I'm sure we could, but this will most certainly lead to timing attacks with, I believe that might be the most obvious result, but no, we didn't look.
One more question? One other question? Yes? I'm coming. No, oh, please. I'm happy to come here. He's warm.
Some exercise for him.
Your project looks amazing. You've got unit tests, Python 2, Python 3, Docker. That's great. I didn't find the documentation.
No, there's no need. There's no need because it's so well written. You don't have that much documentation. I think we have a README and an install file, but we have Docker files. So it's possible to read it. No, there's not the documentation to say how to write a new stub. And clearly this might be of interest because if you want to use it, we can do this.
You want to organize a workshop or?
I'm not sure that no. What would be interesting would be to look at other Oracle padding attacks, like the ones on CBC mode, using the same idea of being modular. But okay, yes, there are no documentation, but okay, I'm not that much convinced that you need a lot of documentation. It's lacking because the code is relatively small. And but yes, you clearly a tutorial saying how you write a stub would be interesting.
When it will be available?
No, you hold the mic. You don't you don't ask questions.
Okay, as a common question. Okay, so let's thank Olivier Hina again.